Now, we can extend this idea in two dimensions, okay, and the answer, I mean the geometry again is very nice, okay. So, what we will do is, in two dimensions, first of all I want to tell you, in one dimension we had no choice, the way to discretize is line segments. In 2D however, we have a choice, okay. So, the elements, it can be like this, triangles. That's what you saw in the very beginning, the aircraft picture was broken into triangles. But is that the only choice?
No.
Right? I can have a square, I mean I can have a rectangle, any number of shapes I can have, right? So, so each element then has inside it some shape functions, okay. So, we will stop calling them basis functions now, we'll start calling them shape functions, so that when you read the literature, it is smooth, right. So, for example, when I took the 1D line segment over here, this had two shape functions, right. Now, when I take a triangle like this, right, the bare minimum would be three shape functions, and we'll discuss how there are three shape functions, right. So, one attached to each node basically. Right. Now, when I go over here, this I can conceivably have four shape functions over here. So, what we are doing is we are bringing in more and more flexibility into modeling the unknown by having these kinds of shape functions over here. Okay. So, that is one thing I wanted to tell you in the case of 2D. Now, one thing you notice that here I am making the unknowns to be the values of the function at these nodes. That is a straightforward extension of what I did in 1D. In 1D, my unknowns were these nodes, from that I defined these shape functions, right, everything is good. I can continue that idea here and say nodes, right. Nodes are the node values are unknowns, and we will see in the next slide how to construct these shape functions, but you get the intuitive idea, nodes are the unknowns. Can there be some other kind of unknown? Well, center point, okay, but that's also a node. So, okay, let me sort of pose this question in another way. Maxwell's equations are essentially vector equations, right? And so my unknowns are actually vectors, but I am trying to express them in terms of scalar nodes. So, what happens to the direction then? So, if I had something like, you know, EZ, I can say, okay, in this is in the XY plane. So, EZ can take, EZ is a function of XY. So, there is a value of EZ is itself a scalar. But what if I wanted to represent a true vector field? Because for example, in this case, H is in plane. In the TM polarization, H is a vector in plane. Supposing I wanted to represent the H vector in plane, will the nodes be useful for me? Node is not going to help me. How do I get direction out of it? It gives me a value, but it doesn't give me direction, right? So, these are what we have looked at so far, these are node based elements. It is also possible to define what are called edge based elements. So, edge based elements. And we will look at both node based and edge based elements. The element shape remains the same, it's a triangle, okay. Now, the unknown over here becomes the value of a vector along a certain edge, okay. So, it might seem a little abstract now, but we'll build it explicitly, everything we'll work it out. But basic, I mean the idea you should keep in mind is, if my unknown now is the magnitude of this vector. So, if it is the magnitude of this vector, I'm at least able to impose a direction along some edge, okay. And similarly for these three edges. And at some point over here, if I want to find out the field, it's going to be a linear combination of something based on these three vectors. So, I am able to associate at each point in space a direction, okay. So, again this is a new concept. So we'll study it in detail. But you should know that there are node-based elements and edge-based elements. Node-based elements typically have limited accuracy compared to edge-based elements. Edge-based elements require you to be very careful about vectors and directions. Okay, so very good question. So he's asking what happens, supposing I have two elements like this. Okay, it's the same as in the case of 1D, I had two elements. The value of this node over here didn't matter, because supposing the shape function took its value over here, then it can go down to here and go up to whatever value over here, because this node value was constant. Similarly, in this, the edge is common to both elements. So the edge direction is consistent between both the elements. So it's not that there is one direction on the left element and another direction on the right element. It's a shared edge. Earlier you had a shared node, now you have a shared edge. So along that shared edge, the direction of the field is unique. There is no flipping happening across. Okay, so will be because the unknown is common between both edges. So it's built into the system of equations that you will get only one direction for each edge. So this guy will have its own other edges pointed any which way. In a combined way, when I look at all the elements of the system, every edge will have a unique direction. So that's what is giving a lot of power in expressing the field as a vector over any funny looking object. Okay? You mean that, for example, if I call this edge A and edge B and edge C, so you're saying that between A and B there's a big jump in direction? That the equations will take care of, because when I impose this weighted residual condition, it will make it consistent such that there is no, finally we are trying to obey Maxwell's equations. Maxwell's equations will not allow a sudden flip between the field at two adjacent points unless there was some material or something like that. So that is built into how we formulate the system of equations. We need not worry about it. So at least as far as electromagnetics goes, these are the kinds of basis functions we use. But electromagnetics are not the, the electromagnetic community is not the first community to do finite element. In fact, the first community were fluid mechanics people, mechanical engineers, aerospace engineers. They also use edge-based elements. Their edge-based elements are slightly different. I'll show you what their fluid mechanics. This is just sort of general knowledge. Their edges, I mean, they don't like edges. What they are concerned about is like fluid flow. They are concerned about how much fluid is flowing across a certain interface. So their basis elements, shape functions look like this actually. These are the common or conserved quantities between elements. A vector which is normal to the edge, that is shared between two elements. So if there's water flowing across an interface, how much comes from the left, that much goes into the right. So that conserved quantity is this green arrow over here. In the electromagnetics case, this arrow, it is ensuring which property of Maxwell's boundary conditions? Tangential continuity. We are building it into the way we design the elements itself. So you get it for free. Similarly, you do a different construction, you get the fluid mechanics case, the normal component is conserved. So you build it in into the solution. You don't have to do something extra to get this property. Yeah, okay. These edge based elements also are, they are named after the scientist who discovered it, Nedelec. But first, we'll start with node-based elements. The number of variables currently is 3 for the simplest node-based or edge-based element. Per element, there are 3 unknowns, and those 3 are of course shared across. If there are n elements in the domain, how many unknowns are there? No, there will not be 3n unknowns because many of the nodes are shared, right? So similarly, in the case of 1D, how many nodes are there? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Sorry, 6. 6 nodes are there. So unknowns are 6. Elements are 5. 5 elements have 6. 5 into 2, 10. You would think 10 nodes per element. But of those, 1, 2, 3, 4 are shared. So 10 minus 4 gives me 6, which is what makes sense. So similar accounting happens in the case of 2 dimensions. Okay. So now let's actually explicitly construct the first node-based element. Okay. So this is the first order node based element. in 2D. Okay, so I take my triangle. Okay, so I'm going to call this node 1, node 2, and node 3. Okay, so what I'm going to do, so I'm going to tell you the final answer and you will wonder how did people come up with it, but you will see once you see it, it's very elegant. What I'm going to do is I'm going to define some arbitrary point P inside this triangle. Okay, remember everything, all this entire discussion that is happening about the shape functions are limited to the interior of this or the element, this triangle, not outside the triangle. Let's connect this hypothetical point to the three nodes. This is my point P. Okay, now I define my first shape function, okay, as the area of triangle 1. So what is triangle 1? It is the area of triangle P23 divided by area of triangle 1 2 3. This is the definition. Okay, so that's why you notice that it's n1. So I exclude 1 and therefore is the area of P23. Okay, so that means this area. Okay, so now let's look at some of the properties of this function over here. So n1e as a function of xy, it is going to be a function of xy, because where is the xy going to come from? It's the coordinates of this point P. The node locations are fixed. P can roam around anywhere inside. As P roams around, my function n1e is now a two-dimensional function. The coordinates will come in over here. Okay. What is its value at node 1? At node 2 and 3, 0, right? The triangle falls flat. So this is like that Lagrange polynomial of the first order case. It is, it had its value 1 at its own location and 0 at the other node. Similarly, this function has its value 1 at a certain node, 0 everywhere else. Okay, not just node 2 and 3, along 2 to 3, still 0, right? So it's like a, it's like a tent, right? The tent has some height over here. If I think of it, it looks something like this, right? It has its value 1 over here, this much is 1, and it goes to 0 at these two points, and it stays 0 along this whole edge until it reaches 2. Okay, now what kind of a functional form do you think this n1e takes? Is it constant, linear, quadratic? What is it? It should be linear in, I mean, in x and y. Okay, so we can use whatever you studied in high school, Hero's formula, whatever it is, right? So x2 3 minus x3 y2. I'll just write down the explicit area of triangle formula. Okay, that's just area of formula, area of triangle. So there are a whole bunch of constants over here, right? Once I have got my geometry, I have made triangles out of it. So the node locations n1, n2, n3, these are fixed. So these are all numbers. So I can reduce, boil this down to a1 plus b1 x plus c1 y divided by, because the denominator is twice the area. So you can see that this is a nice one-dimensional function in x and y. Okay. Similarly, I can define what should I define my N2E as? Triangle 2 by triangle, which is area of P13 by area 1, 2, 3, okay, and N3E is going to be similarly area of P21 okay. So, all of these three shape functions are linear functions. Okay. So, what is the geometric picture you can think of? How, what am I doing to my function? So, you all agree that this visualization that I have shown you over here, like a tent with height 1 at node 1 and 0 by the time it reaches node 2, 3 and the line connecting 2, 3. Now, if I take any function say u of x is equal to alpha n1e plus beta n2e plus gamma n3e, right? So, not x but xy. What is this going to look like? If you wanted to visualize this, what does it look like? A plane, like a tent, again like a tent, and the height of the stand at 1, 2 and 3 is alpha, beta, gamma. Right. So, it is going to be, if I were to use my fantastic drawing skills, this would be alpha, then gamma and beta, and it is a plane that is at suspended by these heights over here. Okay. So, what do you, what will you get when you go to adjacent elements? So, this is one triangle, for example, there will be another triangle over here. Let us say this has some value epsilon. So, when I consider this second triangle, what will be the height of, I mean, what will, how will it look like? It will go from here like this. Another tent over here, but its value along this will be conserved. It will be the same value. There will be no, these two tents will come and meet at the same line. There will be no jump over here because of the way we have constructed it. Whatever is happening at alpha has no influence on this because the shape function corresponding to this becomes 0 by the time you come over here. Similarly, whatever is happening over here has no influence on this. So, this line is dictated purely by beta and gamma, which is common to both of these elements. So, I have got a smooth function, continuous, I mean it is a continuous function, it is not differentiable because you can see it is like two lines meeting here, so differentiability is not there. Even if they do not meet at a,
means you are saying it is converging on
the same line, same the common edge. Yeah. No, that would not happen, right? Supposing your so, let's take a view along this, okay. So, this is your one edge comes in like this, the other edge if it comes like this,
then the third can,
the third has no influence on this line, right. So, this was my, I am looking from here this direction, this was my height alpha and this was my height epsilon. If these two did not meet at the same point, there is no way for you to fix it because whatever is happening here has no role to play over here, whatever is happening here has no role to play over here. The value of the height of this line over here is fixed purely by beta and gamma. So, you get continuity for free. Beta and gamma are shared nodes for the two elements. So, they are shared. They do not have a separate value. So, you can see that it is this very nice continuity property is built into the basis function. So, therefore, the solution that I get, it also obeys, I mean, I am projecting my solution on this basis, it will have these nice properties trivially.